Okay. I would like to start by thanking the organizers for inviting me to this Space Syntax conference, which is very, very interesting. Now, as you can see from the title, I would like to talk about actually the basic question of this session: how complexity network and big data may facilitate our understanding of contemporary cities. Now, this is from the letter of invitation. Now, I will start by saying a few words about terminology. We've heard a lot today about networks and big data, so I'll speak mainly about complexity theory, what it is and how it was related to cities. And then a little bit about the notion of science of cities. Then I will talk about complexity cognition in the city, and I try to convince you that it's important to add cognition to the study of cities, cognition together with complexity. Next, I will talk once again about data, but this time about the distinction between big data and what I suggest here is small data. And finally, I will conclude by suggesting how to study cities. Okay, let's start with complexity. And complexity theory is essentially an umbrella name to a whole set of theories that study open, complex, far from equilibrium systems that achieve their order spontaneously, that is by means of self-organization. Now, such systems exhibit a whole set of phenomena such as scales, fractures, and the like. Some examples, the most of canonical experiments and theories, and the founding theories. The canonical experiment is an experiment by the physicist Benard at the beginning of the 20th century. Probably one of the most famous theories about that is dissipative structure by Ilya Prigozhin, who also got the Nobel Prize for that. Another theory is by Hermann Hacke, a theory which is called synergetics. Now, while Prigozhin had this canonical experiment, the Benard phenomenon, Hacke was using the canonical experiment of the laser beam. There is a very beautiful theory by Mandelbrot, fractal theory, beautiful visually. There is a chaos theory by Lorentz, for example, Feigenbaum and others. And more recently, we have Perlbach, self-organized criticality, and the very recent one is the theory of networks. Also, complexity theory came with a whole set of methodologies. The most well-known ones are cello automata, agent-based, and as I said recently, network analysis, so the new science of network. We have heard a lot today about networks. I just mentioned that network theory is a kind of combination between a work by Milgram, a psychologist, who coined the notion of a small world and 6 degrees of separation, and a new look at it, and by Barabasi and Watts, using graph theory. And the outcome was the new science of network. And the interesting part that it was suggested, specifically by Barabasi, that this is that complex networks are very typical of complex systems, and the idea is that complex systems are complex networks and can be studied by means of the usual tools of network analysis, as we have seen today. A few words about big data. Also, we heard about big data today. Basically, when we say big data, we refer to the new ICT, information communication technologies, which allow us to collect a lot of data, and by means of visual analytic techniques and data mining and so on, it is possible today to make sense out of this huge amount of accumulating data. Michael Batty compares it to the new era of studies about the human genotype, and he adds that we can now trace millions of people whose location and time of travel are recorded digitally. And the science of cities, which is also part of the title. Actually, this is the title of the whole session. We are speaking today about the science of cities. There was a special Nature edition that devoted to the science of the city. We are speaking about the fact that half of humanity nowadays living in cities. There is this new book by Michael Batty, who is about to come out, about the new science of cities. And this, I think, is a very good title, because we already had an old science of cities in the 50s and 60s, specifically, that was built on studies of specifically German economists, such as Kristaller, Losch, Izard, Averbuch, Zipf, Brian-Berry, and others. Okay, so this is the kind of introduction. What I'd like to do now is to switch to the relations between complexity, cognition, and the city. How complexity may facilitate our understanding of how contemporary cities actually work and evolve. Now, implicit in this question is a parallel question, which is how complexity, network, big data can give rise to a new size of cities. And the common answer here is by applying theories of complexity that originally were developed in the hard sciences to the study of cities. And the basic idea is that there are genuine similarities between complex systems revealed in nature and the way cities work and evolve, and the models developed to deal with natural complex systems can be successfully applied to cities. The outcome is what we have defined or called or termed CTC, complexity theories of cities. Now, all complexity theories have been applied to cities, with the implication that we now have this family of complexity theories of cities. I will mention the main one of them. We have dissipative cities that were, which is actually, it's a class of studies that apply Prigozhin dissipative structure to cities by his student, physicist in the past, now urbanist Peter Ellen. There are synergetic cities by Weidlich, Hacken, and myself, who apply synergetics to the study of cities. There are fractal cities, a book by Michael Batty and Peter Longley. We have cellular automata cities, agent-based cities, sandpile cities, which are actually using self-organized criticality, and more recently we have network cities. In this family of complexity theories of cities, we have many papers, few books. Now, each complexity theory emphasizes a different property of the complexity of cities. For example, dissipative cities emphasize interaction with the environment. Here's a quotation from Prigozhin, Krista and Stengers. A crystal, they write, can be maintained in a vacuum, but if you isolate a time, a town, it would die. And if you look at synergetic cities, what you see is a different emphasis. Here the focus is on the bottom-up emergence, which means that cities emerge bottom-up out of the interaction between individuals, but once they come into being, they affect human behavior, or in the technical terminology, they enslave the part of the system and so on in a circular causality. Fractal cities emphasize self-similarity in structure and in road network, and we've seen a little bit of it today. And network cities, by their nature, emphasize connectivity. Okay, complexity, cognition, and the city. The claim in this book is that applying complexity theories from the hard sciences to the study of cities is useful but not enough. Indeed, there are genuine similarities between complex systems in nature and the way cities work and evolve, but there are also differences. And in order to understand cities, we have to look at the differences, at the uniqueness and peculiarities of cities as complex systems, and the methodological implication thereof. Now, what are the uniqueness of cities as complex systems? Well, first, cities are artifacts, artificial complex systems. Now, what I suggest here is actually a distinction between simple and complex artifacts. And the question is, what makes an artifact complex? And the answer can be seen here. A car or any machine is a simple artifact. You put a driver behind the wheel, it becomes complex. A city, empty city, just the buildings and streets, etc., is a simple collective artifact. You put people inside and you get a complex artificial system. A supercomputer might be extremely complicated, but essentially simple artifact. You put a person behind it, a human being behind it, and it becomes a complex artifact. And this is beautifully illustrated in a book by Wiseman, The World Without Us, and we can change it into the cities without urban agents, and they show that if we humans one day disappear, evaporate, in a very short period of time, our cities, in fact, our whole culture, we simply be disintegrated in the environment. So the connection to the environment by us humans and all the other properties are what is making our cities complex. Second uniqueness concerns the part of cities, the urban agents. They differ from natural complex parts of natural complex systems in several respects. First of all, they have a mind and brain and a specific kind of memory. Second, due to their specific kind of mind and brain, they differ also from organic parts, like animals, in that they produce a language, text, and artifacts, or in short, they produce culture. Now, what I want to draw your attention to is that cities as artifacts are full of language and text. When all buildings in a city are identical or different or very different, it is hard to find your way. By giving buildings and streets names, you can make each one unique and then enable navigation in the city. This is so with buildings, streets, neighborhoods, and the like. Another point is that due to culture, humans are subject, in fact, and this is actually one of the most important points, humans are subject to two evolutionary processes. One is the slow biological evolution, and the second one is the fast cultural evolution. Cities in this respect are what I would like to call dually complex systems. Let me elaborate on it a little bit. Now, an atom might be very complicated, but still a simply behaving part in the sense that the collective effect, as in the example, for example, in the Bernard convection cell, the emergence of a complex system has no effect on the structure of the atom as the parts of the system, only on their behavior. So what we have here, for example, in a physical complex system, we have simple parts that by means of their interaction give rise to a global system. The same happens with an organic system, even though this bell is by definition a complex system. It is a complex adaptive self-organizing system by virtue of the fact that it is subject to the slow process of biological evolution. But the collective phenomenon that you see here has no effect, no feedback impact on the single bell. So it can ignore. And again, we can apply the relations as before. Singularly complex local parts give rise to a global system. The situation is different with the Homo sapiens sapiens, which means us, because we are constantly subject to two evolutionary processes, the biological evolution on the one hand and the fast cultural evolution on the other hand. And the fast cultural evolution has immediate effect on our behavior and on our structure. So here we cannot ignore it. And we have here doubly complex local parts give rise to complex a global artificial system, namely a city. To conclude, cities are hybrid artificial natural systems and they are different from natural material systems. Each of their elementary parts, human agents, human organizations and so on, is by itself a complex system. Cities are thus dually complex systems. Now, another point is that due to their specific mind and body, humans, have a specific kind of memory, which is called a chronostatic memory, which enable us to travel, or mentally travel, in time. Now, in the past, this idea was suggested by a Tulbingesell hypothesis. Now we know that there is a certain location in the brain that is responsible to our ability to mentally travel in time, back to the past and forward to the future. In fact, and actually we are speaking today about several forms of chronostasia, like prospective memory, and actually also about what is called cognitive planning. Now, what I would like to emphasize is that we humans, we tend to travel in time back to the past as well as forward to the future, and actually we cannot avoid doing so. And we can see this by the fact that it takes a lot of mental effort to meditate, to do meditation, just in order to be for a while in the here and now. We are usually somewhere in the future or somewhere in the past, and very rarely we are here, by the way. Okay, now there is an interesting implication to that, and this that humans, because of mental time traveling, are natural planners and designers, and as such they produce artifacts. Planning and design are direct manifestations of chronostatic and constructive memory. Humans are therefore natural planners and designers. Not only that humans have the ability to mentally travel in time, but they cannot not mentally travel in time, back to the past and to the future, and urban agents, as natural planners and designers, cannot not plan and design. From here follow two kinds of behavior which are interesting, planning behavior and design behavior, and the idea is that humans behave and act in response, in response to plan or design, that is, in response to a reality that doesn't yet exist and might actually never exist. And the question is how? How do people plan and how do people design? And the answer we suggest in the paper from 1996 that was elaborated during the years is that by means of what we call SIRN, synergetic interrepresentation networks. And the basic idea is that humans plan, design, and produce artifacts by means of an ongoing interaction between internal representation constructed by their minds and brain and external representation constructed by them in the world. And we have identified and elaborated three forms of a synergetic interpresentation network. We call it intrapersonal, interpersonal, and collective. Here are a few examples. This is a well-known sculpture by Brancusi, and this is an example of interpersonal. It started at the beginning of the 20th century with the kiss, and as you can see, by means of this play between internal and external, the shape of it became more and more abstract until in 1937, when Brancusi was doing the Gate of the Kiss in the Bucharest, it became completely geometrical. A similar process of interpersonal you can see in the Bull by Picasso, that gradually, by this play between internal representation and external representation, becomes more and more abstract. And there are also other examples. An example of interpersonal is, for example, the production of an artifact such as a lamp. The first lamp top on the top is actually a lamp from the second millennium BC, one of the first that we find, at least in the Middle East. Now, let us assume that there is this lamp, and the potter number one looks at this, internalize this structure in his mind or her mind, and then produce out of memory the second one, the second lamp, and so it goes on and on until we get lamps of today. Actually, the inspiration for this play between internal and the external is the so-called barter scenarios of serial production produced by him as means to study the working of memory. Which is the title of his book. He showed a person a shape or a story, like the shape of the old top left, and asked the person to memorize it, then to produce it out of memory. He showed the second one to a second person, and as you can see, there was here a face transition. At a certain stage, it became a cat, and from now on, it stabilized. We have devised such a process to study collective interpresentation dynamics, and we show it by means of a city game. It's very similar to the bidding ring model that Bill Hillier was developing a long time ago, with one important addition. What we have here a process of self-organization by which the dynamics is affected by what's going on the ground, not only by general syntactic rules. And you see here how a collective effect is taking place in a simple game, and we suggest also that it applies to the dynamics of cities. Now, those are intuitive examples. We have developed this idea also mathematically by means of Haken's synergetic approach to self-organization. And the basic idea is that the interaction between the internal and external parts gives rise to an emerging order parameter, those are technical terms, that then enslave the parts and so on in circular causality. I will not go into the details of it. I will just add that we have applied this model also to planning, to actually a planning discourse, and we have applied it also just recently by Herbert Stolk and myself to urban design. What you see here is a design by means of sketches, this time by Calatrava. This is the top one, At the bottom, we have shown, and this is a paper by Kim Tan and myself, we show how this how the city game that I've just described can be used as a kind of design games. Okay, now let us talk about methodology a little bit. Let us talk about data. And I make a reference here, as you can see, to a very famous book by Schumacher, Small is Beautiful, Economics as if People Matter, and I would like to transform it, that small data is beautiful, a science of cities as if people matter. Now, how to study cities as complex systems? The fashionable answer these days is big data, as we have just seen. Now, if you look at, there has been a paper in physics, recent Physics Today, and the title was Smart Cities Will Need Big Data. And in it, physicist Kooning, the new head of the New York University Center for Urban Science and Progress, says the following. Physics is an attitude as well as a subject. The kind of skill physicists bring to think about through complicated situations, data-driven and so on, are not at all common in urban science and technology at this point. Physicists have a lot to bring to the table here. Now, it is true that big data represent physicalism, a physicist view on cities. Yet Kooning, as well as his interviewers, are simply wrong in implying that it is only now that physicists step into the study of cities. We already had several physicalist waves in the study of cities. The previous one, in the 50s and 60s, the so-called quantitative revolution, specifically in urban geography, started actually with great enthusiasm, but ended with a major frustration. A case in point is David Harvey, a leading theoretician of the quantitative urbanism of the 60s, who in the early 70s wrote that the positivist or physicalist approach is incapable of saying anything of depth and profundity about cities. And the result was actually an unbridgeable cultural gap between quantitative physicalist science of cities versus qualitative social theory oriented study of cities, very much in line with what we heard today about snow to culture. But there is also another example to this tension between big data and small data, between external view and internal view. And this example comes from the emergence in the middle of the 1950s of cognitive science, the so-called the mind's new science. People such as Alan Turing, Noam Chomsky, Edward Coleman, and others demonstrated that the black box approach of behaviorism is not sufficient. That the study of internal replacement must be added in order to fully understand human behavior. Now, unlike urban studies, the emergence of the cognitive science was not associated with a total rejection of behaviorist principles, such as classical conditioning, but rather with the view that the external behaviorist properties and the internal cognitive properties are two facets of a single system. And in fact, I suggest that unlike urban studies of the 60s, complexity theory and the complexity theories of cities are capable of accommodating both the externalized view of big data and the internalized view of small data. And I suggest that complexity theories of cities should follow the example of the brain, the ultimate complex system, how to study the brain. Now, we know that there are two basic approaches. There are top-down approaches, like fMRI, etc., that similarly to big data approaches, searches for overall patterns when the brain is executing a certain task, and there are also bottom-up small data approaches that explore the behavior of individual neurons, as illustrated by Nobel laureate Eric Kandel. Studying single brain neurons entailed major breakthroughs about the way our memory works. In a more recent book, Kandel showed that the operation of the brain itself, for example in visual perception, evolves as an interaction between analytical bottom-up local processes, small data processes if you wish, and synthetic top-down global processes. Big data processes, if you wish. In fact, all complexity theories deal with this play between the local and the global, between the small and the big. As conceptualized by Hermann Hack in synergetics, the local parts, by means of their interaction, give rise to global system, which then enslave the parts in its rhythm, and so on in circular causality. So, methodologically speaking, synergetic cities actually suggest that the local small data processes give rise to the emergence of the global big data processes, but once the big data comes into existence, it informs or prescribes the local small data and so on in circular causality. So the way, and there are actually several ways to generate and use small data in cities. While this area has yet to be developed, we can already mention a few such ways. One source might be, or one source of inspiration, might be cognitive science. Part of its methodology is focused on individuals, their motivations and action. Such methodologies range from hard laboratory experiments through observations and questionnaires to soft, deep and open interviews. An interesting small data, another source which is interesting is Hagerstrand time geography, that by mapping the daily life paths of individuals exposes the various personal, collective and institutional constraints within which urban agents live and act. And there are other methodologies as well. So, how such concepts as complexity, network, big data may facilitate our understanding of how contemporary cities actually work and evolve? The answer suggested here by developing a Janus phase theoretical and methodological approaches. First, by complementing the natural science-derived complexity theories of cities with a cognitive dimension that will take account of the peculiarities of cities as hybrid artificial natural complex systems. Secondly, by complementing the big data methodologies with small data approaches that will enable a study of complex systems such as cities as if people matter. Thank you for your attention.